A full commitment's what I'm thinking of. You wouldn't get this from any other guy. Ladies, gentlemen, and variations thereupon, this is Modern Escape. Hello, pop pickers, and welcome to the 1980s. My name is DJ Oodle Sinclair, and it's time to introduce the UK's top four. In at number four, and a non-mover, it's Gadget.
Hello.
Down two places, and last week's number one, it's Stig.
Aww.
A brand new entry to the UK top four, and straight in at number two, it's Candy, but she can't be with us tonight due to touring in China. And that's right, you've guessed it. We have a new UK top four number one, singing live tonight with his debut single, Bigging Up the Boomers, it's Biggie! Yes!
Don't top it away. Something for once.
Are you going to sing?
No.
Okay. Before we get into the show, please consider becoming one of our sexy and incredibly cool patrons. Help us divide and conquer the podcasting world. Details are in our show notes, but mainly check out our website, modernescapism.co.uk, for more exquisite content and links to everything we do. Do you know what? I weren't on last week. Gadget weren't on last week.
No.
Do you know what we've been really missing?
We've been lacking it.
Pining for.
I've tried taking supplements for it, and I just can't find it.
Yeah, I've been pining for something. What could it be? I need some news.
Don't know which one was worse.
Somehow that was worse.
Keep it in.
You may already know, but he doesn't, because it's time for Biggie's Breaking News.
So, first up, Xbox boss Phil Spencer has made Microsoft's promise yet again around the future of Call of Duty on PlayStation platforms. This time, he's come out and said that as long as there's a PlayStation out there to ship to, it will still be on there. So, I'm really not sure what's going on with this, because Sony kicked off about COD may or may not be on PlayStation, even though they've got exclusivities around Call of Duty themselves. It's all been a bit of a mess, but yeah, apparently Phil Spencer's still going to allow it to be on PlayStation. So
it's a fucking mockery, the whole figure. Thing.
Yeah, they were trying to get the Competition Markets Authority and our government to basically block the merger of Activision and block Xbox from buying Activision. That's all it was. Because Sony just can't seem to get a foothold in anything because they're shit these days.
Mm-hmm. These days, it's been like this for a good few years, mate.
But it does feel like a bit of jab, doesn't it? As long as the PlayStation for it to be on.
Oh yeah, that's
soon there won't be.
Yeah, definitely
this
feels
is the last one.
Definitely feels like a loaded statement, that, doesn't it?
Yeah, when Microsoft buy them next year.
Imagine that.
Oh, mate, weirder things have happened.
He's going to get Phil Spencer and Jim Ryan doing that fight with the spears from Star Trek.
Yeah.
Was there a rumor that they were going to try and get the Xbox Game Pass running on a PlayStation?
No,
not on Nintendo.
Somewhere.
Yeah, they wanted to get xCloud going on the Switch.
Which would be great for Microsoft to get into Japan, in my opinion.
It would be the easiest way for them to get into Japan, because they don't sell many Xboxes over there.
No. They don't like they don't like anything that's basically not homegrown, other really.
I mean, to be fair, I think it's because the original Xbox marketing was trash. Have you not seen those adverts of Bill Gates holding a cheeseburger that came out when the Xbox was going to be released in Japan? Very culturally insensitive.
Yeah. Next.
Well, more PlayStation news. As PlayStation Club... start again. PlayStation Plus subscriber numbers are down by 2 million despite their revamping the PlayStation Plus tiers. Game sales are also down year on year as PlayStation 5 passes 25 million consoles shipped. Interestingly, PlayStation Plus had 45.4 million subscribers as of 30th of September this year, is down more than 2 million from 47.2, which is signed up at the same point in 21.
I mean,
I get PS Plus if there's a game I don't own, and then I stop the automatic renewal.
Yeah.
It's rare I do it nowadays.
Very rare. I have it because I still like to play like Elden Ring online and stuff like that. You know, I still like to do the odd bit of online stuff.
I had to do that when I was in the fight clubs, but I've weaned myself off that.
But, I mean, the thing is, Sony kind of fucked it up by doing this kind of very complicated three-tier thing. I've got the mid-tier, so I've got the one which comes with the game collection thing, like with all the older games on. But you see you go into the PlayStation Plus homepage and it says, "Oh, get demos of this brand new game," and I've got to be on the next tier up. You know,
yeah.
You could, if they had to have different tiers, you could just have a two-tier thing. You know,
that's all they needed to do, the
cheap one, and then the one with like all the extra game collection stuff.
I mean, the extra one has got a lot of games on.
Yeah, like, it does.
It doesn't rival Game Pass as in getting new games.
Well, that's the other thing because
the quality that's there is fucking good.
Yeah, that's the other thing that they're not putting first party exclusives onto it.
No, and that's what Game Pass has over the competition. Yeah. And you can't argue with that.
Like, imagine how many more people that have signing up if you could play God of War this week on it without having to spend £70 on a disc.
Imagine how many millions would lose in that multi-million dollar game that they've made.
That's true, yeah.
Do you know what the best thing about all this was? Their statement about that it's because people are going outside.
Yeah. What? There's another realm out there?
Yeah, but it's like people are going outside and that's why they're not subscribing to PS Plus. Yeah, that's it.
They said that a few years, well, quite a while back now, with the PS3, do you know when they had PS Plus on there?
Yeah.
And they were saying, oh, we're blaming club culture, why people, they're not staying at home and playing Wipeout anymore. It's like, what? What you mean to say is these kids are not kids anymore and they're going out. So they're not back getting PlayStation Plus. Fucking idiots. Sony is stupid.
Oh, they are. They're the worst.
Well, speaking of which, finally, PlayStation VR 2 was announced with the pricing.
Another one.
Pre-orders will begin on November the 15th and players may begin to register as live as this podcast is out. Now, it's going to be priced in the UK at £529.99.
More than the console.
And all you get is the headset.
£7 million.
The VR2 Sense controllers and stereo headphones.
Mate, at that price, for a proprietary accessory, it may as well be the Nintendo VR Boy thing, whatever it were called.
Virtual Boy.
It may as well be that. Yeah. At that fucking price,
the thing is
that is ridiculous when you can get an Oculus for cheaper.
Yeah.
Or Meta.
That's the thing. I've no doubt it will be better than an Oculus because, you know, they've put a lot more money into it and
it's newer.
Oculus is 2 years old, fine. But at £529, I think what would make it an absolute killer app that people would pay into is if you could use it for PC VR as well.
Yes,
if you could use it, because it's got the inside-out tracking, it's got its own controllers, everything maps to everything these days. If you could use it as a HMD for PC VR, great, that would be perfect. I would pay £530 for that.
Yeah, as like a multifunctioning device.
But as something that can,
a different story, that
something that can only be used for the PS5 that you have to have wired. It's not wireless. is not backwards compatible with previous gen PSVR, so you can't play Resident Evil 7 on it.
Nope. Absolutely stupid.
Can't play.
You can pay £569 to get Horizon Call of the Mountain bundle.
So you get 40,
because that'll actually come with a game that you could use it with.
So it's a £40 game.
You mean a 3-hour experience, not a game?
It's going to be an experience game, isn't it?
They don't give away games free, mate. Nobody does.
Well, you're paying £40 for it.
Oof. Fucking hell. Man.
Yeah.
Absolute stupendous.
I did call this, though. I said it would be more expensive than the console. And
yeah. You did. You did nail it. Yeah, you did.
It's
stupid.
It's so many bad decisions because the tech is probably great. It's probably a really nice headset to use. But it being so restricted what you can use it with is just absolutely going to kill it, and the price.
The wildest thing, when you think to like bedrooms and how people want the setups, you can get the cheapest PS5, the discless, and the Xbox Series S are cheaper than getting that in the bundle.
Yeah.
So you can have the best of both worlds for cheaper than having this new, again, proprietary compound.
Exactly. I mean, if you didn't already have a PS5 and you wanted to get that the headset, and then Horizon Call of the whatever it's called, Call of the Mountain. £1,040.
The biggest problem as well for me is I don't trust Sony and game developers
to stick with it.
Mm. Well, they proved
PSVR 1, like, just
yeah, they didn't support it at all.
Barely got any big games on it. Yeah.
It was like 2 years worth of support they gave it, and then it just kind of like dropped.
People were saying,
you need to get a PSVR. It's worth it just for Astrobot. Is it? Is it really?
Is it really worth it for one game? No, not for one game, but it's really good.
That's like saying a PS5 is worth it for Astrobot. It's a great little game.
It is a good game.
But you don't buy a PS5 for it.
I've not played it since the first week I had the PS5.
Exactly.
Still not finished it. It's so good in VR, though.
I'll spoil ending. There's fireworks.
The thing is, when you play it in VR, though, you can't help but like wave at him. He's like looking up at you, just like, hi. And he just waves back, and you're just like, yeah.
You know what? When I do this podcast, I tickle Biggie's head all the way through it. So I'm going to be tickling Astrobot.
I'm going to tickle Biggie's head right now.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? It's a good feeling.
Next. Kojima Productions has revealed Japanese-Australian actress Shioli Kitsuna will star in its upcoming and now somewhat mysterious new game. She was best known for her role as Yukio in Deadpool 2. There's also roles in Murder Mystery and The Outsider.
Hasn't this also got Elle Fanning?
Elle Fanning's in it. I'm enjoying the reveals. I'm kind of like just waiting. Okay, give us. I mean, the thing is, he's going to announce the game, and then we're still not going to know what it's about for 5 years.
In 2025.
Yeah.
I'll take anything from Kojima, and I know it's fanboyism, but inject him into my veins. I'm fine. I'll take it. Whatever it is, I'll take it.
Need sci-fi from him again.
I think we should have sci-fi again. That's where he's at his best, I think.
To be fair, Death Stranding was pretty sci-fi. It was just heavily political as well.
Yeah, but I mean, like, in space.
Oh, yeah, send some shit to space. Yeah. Here's another Zone of the
Enders. Some police snorts and stuff. Zone of the Enders, police snorts. I want to get into old school. Yes.
Actually, go back with the previous story. Give us VR Zone of the Enders.
Oh. Yeah.
That would get you to buy noodles.
It would a little. Oh, fuck.
imagine if his game came out and it was a VR game.
Oh, I'd die.
A Kojima game you can't lie in bed to play.
I'd have to go on Money Saving Expert or Money Supermarket and get a good credit card just to pay it off.
God. Go sell your kidney down cash converters.
I've only got one left.
New evidence has been discovered that points towards PvP DLC coming to potential game of the year, Elden Ring. As found by data miner Sekiro Doobie. The latest update to the game includes data for text banners that read things like, you win, you lose, draw, and begin match. And
this is what I said, Gadget, probably. About the Colosseum.
Yeah, exactly. That's why I put it in here.
I get PS Plus again then.
Yeah, there's also been stuff with it. There's entries in the code now for an additional 30 or 36 bosses.
So
people are assuming any DLC is going to be substantial.
Do you know that
there's also entries in the code for, I think, 2 legacy dungeons.
Nice. The way I think of it now, if FromSoft wanted to be clever, get that released early next year, then they can have even more time on whatever they're cooking next.
I think if it was coming out early next year, we would have had an announcement by now. I think they'll announce it next summer for, like, this time next year.
Wow, yeah, maybe. Yeah. I mean, I know they've got multiple teams now, haven't they? They've started to, because they're massive now. So they've got time to, maybe 2 games a year or something like that.
I think it'll be a game every 2 years from them. That seems to be the current rate.
Mm. Yeah, I'm cool with that.
Okay, over to the world of film. Stig's world has been rocked. As Raya and the Last Dragon director Carlos Lopez Estrada will write and direct the live-action remake of Your Name, the movie.
I don't want it either.
Nobody wants.
I think Your Name's such a special film on it as it is.
I haven't even seen the film, but everyone on Twitter is like, no, we don't want this. Who asked for this? Nobody wants it. By all
Hollywood,
accounts,
because God. Hollywood loves trying to remake anime films and TV shows with Western people, and it never fucking works.
Nope. It's just a really good film anyway, just to watch. It doesn't need adjustment. It doesn't need enhancing or remaking. It's just perfect as it is.
Yeah. Watch the animated film. Yeah. Who cares? It's just, oh, it's a cartoon. It
doesn't matter that fantastic it's a cartoon, does it?
It's still a fantastic film. It's one of the best animated films I've ever seen. I absolutely adore it. And, you know, I didn't even like Raya and the Last Dragon, so, you know, that's even worth, like, another fucking X in my box.
Yeah.
Something else the world didn't ask for. Jerry Ginger Spice Halliwell Homer, as she's now known, and Digimon
Halliwell Hunsu. Horner.
What did you say? Homo?
Horner.
I thought you said Homer. Horner.
Homer.
Nope. Has been cast in Sony's up-and-coming Gran Turismo movie. And it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that she possibly is married to team principal of Red Bull's Formula One team, Christian Horner.
Hang on, though.
Is this going to be on the level of Rita Ora and Fast and the Furious, though, where all she'd just stand there at the start?
I was literally going to say that. Like, we've seen this before.
Well, can you run her over? I don't know.
I even forgot they were doing a film, for fuck's sake. Gran Turismo.
She's going to turn around. For that kind of film. They're going to be racing, and she's going to be on the racetrack. She'll turn around and go, stop right now.
Don't forget, David Harbour's also in it. He was the first member of the cast to be officially revealed.
I don't know.
Directed by Neil Blomkamp.
Hit and miss. Hit and miss.
More misses than hits.
A lot more misses.
I mean, District 9's excellent, but I haven't seen anything else by him that I've liked.
No. At least it was shit, weren't it?
And Chappie has DeAntwoord in it, so it's automatically terrible.
It's banned.
Next. Something that we are looking forward to is Paramount's new Dungeons & Dragons Honor Amongst Thieves. But its release date has been pushed back to looking at a March 2023 release now.
I mean, you said we're all looking forward to it. One of us in particular is looking forward to it.
Yeah.
And that's Gadget. He wants to get tips from that film.
It's not even that it's a Dungeons & Dragons film. It's just I've seen the trailer a few times now. It just looks like big, dumb fun.
Mm. And there's room for that.
Yeah,
there's
room
for that.
And I was reading in the article about why it was delayed. It's because they want to give it a good stretch because the Ant-Man is out in the middle of February.
I was going
to
say, it's because of Ant-Man.
Yeah, so they kind of don't want to... it's probably slightly different audiences for it, but they don't want to kind of risk losing money on having it all taken by a Marvel film being out at the time.
Yeah. I tell you what...
Go on.
We never really touched. I know I'm deviating here, but speaking of Ant-Man, we didn't really touch on the trailer, did we, when that came out?
No, we didn't.
I haven't seen it yet, actually.
Yeah. I really like the look of Kang.
I do.
Yeah. He's going to be great, isn't he? I don't think he's going to be.
They need something there, don't they?
Yeah, they need a big
boss.
We're
just forgetting that the phase that we've had. We're just forgetting it. Start again.
Yeah, it's very CGI heavy, but I think you're going to have to do that if you're in the quantum realm. Like, there's no other way around it. Yeah, there's no other way around it, but I'm looking forward to that. I think it's going to be
I go see all the Marvel films in cinemas, but I've got to decide which of the other two films that are not Marvel I will go see next year, because it's never a lot. It's got to be June, hasn't it? But then again, I didn't watch the first one in cinemas either.
I think you need to witness it in the cinema.
Yeah, I think I missed out, didn't I? And I don't think the second film that's non-Marvel I'll go see is Dungeons & Dragons. I'll probably wait for that one. There's a few of it. Oppenheimer's probably the number one I want to see.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to see D&D in the cinema. Oppenheimer and Dune Part 2 are the big ones.
Wait, remind me, what's Oppenheimer? You guys are talking about this. I forgot to ask what it is.
Nolan's.
Yeah, it's Christopher Nolan's next film. It's about Robert Oppenheimer, the guy who invented the nuclear bomb.
The guy who said, oh shit, why did they invent this? Bollocks.
Yeah, the guy who fucked us all.
I think the actual quote is, I have become destroyer of worlds.
Yeah. also at the end, bollocks.
That's how the film ends.
Yeah, bollocks.
I'm not going to lie, I'm 100% going to see that Mario film. It's on my birthday weekend. It's on my birthday weekend. You will. I'm taking the kids.
I am not going to see a Mario film in cinema. Even though it looks good, I'm not going to do it.
100%.
I didn't even see the trailer for 2 weeks. No,
Mushroom Kingdom, here we come. That's about as good as he sounded.
I'm keeping that as a sample.
Yep.
Yeah. Next.
Moving on. A game you may not have heard of called The Last of Us. The TV show now premieres on the 18th of January on Sky.
16th. You read your own note wrong, you dickhead. 16th of January.
Yeah, sorry.
you need new glasses, pal.
I do.
No, I haven't got mine on today, and I'm still reading the notes well.
This is going well.
Good, something to look forward to in the new year.
Yeah, I'll
definitely get Now TV.
I notice that they always schedule kind of like dark, horrible dramas for January when everyone's as depressed as fuck.
Hey, I get my week off in January. I'll be buzzy. Yeah. It'll be my favourite month.
You'll not remember it. You'll be drunk all of it.
Nah, oh, I need to lay off it after last night. Fuck.
Yes, listeners, Oodles is hanging again.
That's why my voice just sounds like this. I'm fucked. Next
up, Kristin Milioti from How I Met Your Mother and Palm Springs fame has joined HBO's Max's The Batman spin-off series based on The Penguin, where she'll play Sophia Falcone.
She's really good.
She's great.
I like her. Yeah, I like her in Palm Springs, so yeah. I've got no qualms with this.
Yeah, really looking forward to that as well.
What they do with that.
Yeah, me too. He was class in the Batman.
Oh, so good. So good.
Deserved a bit more screen time, I thought.
I think they did it deliberately to make this next one.
Mm.
People wanting,
extremely happy about the next bit of news is that Sandman has been renewed for season 2 at Netflix.
Mate, me, and thousands of people on Twitter were like, oh, they're gonna fuck Gaiman over and we're not going to get this because to keep doing that to him. And they've defied the odds. We've got it. We've got season 2.
He could
wrap the whole tale up with this season if he wanted to. If he's not going to get another one, we can have a complete saga. So, oh, God. Best show of here.
It was really good. I really enjoyed it.
Stretch.
So I'm finished it.
Oh, God.
I haven't started it yet. I will do.
Last episode. Do you know what, actually? I know that you were all raving about the diner episode, which was very good. But I really like the death episode.
Death episode was great. Hit you hard. Yeah,
that's the one that made me cry.
The first, it's brutal, that first half. But then it just takes that twist halfway through and starts telling a completely different story. But I was really into that story.
Yeah, it was very good.
Yeah.
Also, please, more Gwendolyn Christie as Lucifer. I was very much into that.
Which is one of the best changes I've ever seen. Because, again, they couldn't use the Lucifer from the show, Lucifer, because they don't own that.
No.
Even though that is the same character. So who else could be the embodiment of hell? It's Gwendolyn Christie. It's perfect. Perfect.
Love it.
Absolutely.
She was very much a mood, as the kids say.
Absolutely. Fantastic. Can't wait for that.
Something that people can't wait for anymore is that HBO has cancelled Westworld, ended the sci-fi drama after 4 seasons.
Is that
seasons.
Still going?
Not anymore.
Yeah. I only thought there were 1 season.
No, season 4 came out this year.
I watched season 1, started season 2, fell off after 3 episodes, and
I didn't even know there was season 2.
It's a shame for fans and the cast that they don't get to come finish the story. I really don't like it when that happens, but they are getting paid for it.
Fine. They're not crying then, are they?
I think season 4 ended with a cliffhanger as well, because I think it was intended to be a 5-season arc.
That's the worst. Yeah. That's the worst. Like, if you finish a season and there's no cliffhanger, fine. I'll be annoyed because there's no more. But it's when they leave you with a cliffhanger, then they cancel it. And
if the showrunners are really clever, if they want to be clever and help the fans make themselves feel better, they'll do a 15-minute digital graphic novel and drop it on YouTube for free to wrap it up. That's what I'd do if they cancelled my show. I'd just do it on my own back. But then again, I don't make my own show, apart from this one.
Yeah. That's it for the news.
Excellent, excellent. Oh, I needed that. It's cheered me up. It's made me feel better. And I want to say as well, I went on last episode and Gadget went, I really enjoyed that, guys.
Yeah, it was good. It was a good episode.
It was a good episode. And Super Natty Cat, she pulled it out of the bag at the last minute.
Thank you to her for stepping in, because I pulled out at the last minute. I wasn't feeling well on the day, so.
That's what she said.
Hey.
Before I did.
Let's move on to the Nexus, and I want to know what Biggie's done.
Biggie's done.
Yeah. I have to get Dean to do another tune.
If he can read his own notes, he'll be able to tell you.
So I finally got around to seeing the movie Smile.
Out of the fucking third attempt of it.
Oh, did you watch the cinema this time?
I watched it as well, so I've got thoughts.
I still haven't got my car back. So
fucking hell.
Smile is a 2022 American psychological horror film written and directed by Parker Finn in his feature directorial debut. And it's based on a 2020 short film that he did called Laura Hasn't Slept. It stars Sosie Bacon, who is actually Kevin Bacon's daughter, if those didn't know.
Really? Oh, wow.
As a therapist called Rose, who saw her own mother sadly take her own life. So she's trained to be a therapist to try and help others after feeling the guilt that she couldn't help her own mother. After witnessing the bizarre suicide of a patient, she goes through increasingly disturbing and daunting experiences, leading her to believe what she's experiencing is supernatural. Also stars, I think it's Rob Morgan, who was in The Boys. Is that right? Who else is in there?
Yes, it is. He plays A-Train in The Boys.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
I really enjoyed this. It doesn't do much new with sort of horror tropes in that respect. But what
you
I did
do
like
your horrors, though, don't you? Big style.
Well, it was the horror month, wasn't it? So it's kind of, I need to move on from horror movies for a little bit. But I really, really enjoyed this. The jump scares throughout are there. Horror fans will not be disappointed. But I thought the sound design was really good. It's very the score is really unsettling. Mm-hmm. And certain sounds are amplified and sort of isolated, sort of build up the tension in certain scenes. I just thought it was excellent. I wanted to give a quick shout out to the marketing as well. For those that don't know, distributors hired actors to promote the film in the US by having actors appear at various football games.
Just smiling.
Creepily stand there doing the smile that's famous from the posters.
That's what that was. I saw that on Reddit. I didn't realize it was related to that film.
Yeah, they just had people standing there the whole game just smiling at the camera.
The actual film was marketed on every bus shelter, every bus, side of every bus, on billboards, and it was very just a person smiling or something like that. Very, very clever.
Really creepy.
Mm.
Yeah, I loved it. I thought it was great. I mean, it's not the best horror movie you'll ever see, but what it was, I thought it was excellent.
It fills a void because there wasn't that many, I don't think, this year.
There's a few.
Oh, I disagree with that.
Really? Halloween Ends, that was shite. I didn't like Terrifier. That.
There you go.
Barbarian many good ones, was really good.
Barbarian's up there, but...
My
issue with Smile is It Follows and The Ring do it better.
Right.
So it's basically kind of doing the same thing. If you've seen It Follows, it's pretty much the same film. Mm. But I think It Follows, it does it better because of that slow... If you've seen that film, that slow, just like impending doom of watching
Is It Follows
constantly.
The shagging one?
The one, where it's someone just like, it kind of... Yeah. And they just have someone walking after you. Constantly walking after you. Like, it's that feeling of looking back and just seeing them walking, and no matter where you go, whatever you do in the world, you could travel to the side of the world and it will find you.
Yeah, I mean, the problem is, like, you compare it to, like, that and Ringu, which is probably, if not the best horror film ever made, do you know what I mean? It's hard to... It's a tough pill to swallow, but if, like you say, it's good... Sometimes that's all you need from an horror film, especially with like Halloween Ends.
That was just trash. No, it's middle of the road and I enjoyed it. And I, like Biggie said, the sound design in it is brilliant. That does ramp up the tension. There's some good jump scares in there, a few that got me. So
Yeah.
And Sozy was fantastic in it. I thought showing the sort of breakdown of someone psychologically was brilliant. I thought a lot of people don't obviously, it's that usual, she's trying to explain, you know, things are happening and, you know, it's something sort of supernatural. Everyone's just looking at it like you're off your head. You know, it's just kind of, she did that very well.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. I'm glad you enjoyed it.
And
mate.
I played another game that you may have heard of called Marvel Snap.
Oh, never heard
which
of
I've it. Really enjoyed. Yeah, I've enjoyed playing that, but I'm nowhere near the levels that Mr. Oodles is.
Good segue. My turn. I've been playing Marvel Snap for the last 2 weeks.
Have you?
Tell us about that, Oodles.
Yeah, I've heard nothing about this.
Yeah, oh, right. Oh, well, let me enlighten you. So, Marvel Snap is a digital collectible card game. Don't go to sleep. Don't go to sleep. Wake up. Developed by Second Dinner and published by Newverse for Windows, Android, and iOS. And it's developed by over half of the team of Hearthstone as well. So it's got pedigree. And you can play it without feeling bad as well. So, for people that don't know, it's set in the Marvel comic universe, not the MCU. So I'm allowed to talk about it. So players each have a deck of 12 cards. Each card depicts a Marvel character with cost, power level, and potentially a special ability. So far, it's Magic the Gathering so far, isn't it?
Basically, yep.
And Hearthstone and Gwent. At the start of each round, players simultaneously put a card face down on one of the three locations. So there's three zones that you've got to win. And basically, sometimes you get an effect that changes the playing field or destroys a card or destroys your own to make a different one stronger. You get it. You've played Magic the Gathering. You've played Hearthstone. You've played Gwent. You've played all that. It's that, right?
Right.
There are no pay-to-win microtransactions in this game.
I like it.
Round of applause.
So you can't... So there's no, like, card packs or anything?
Nope. Nope. So everything you get... I mean, like... You can, now this is the only negative, you can pay to get cards a month early.
Right.
Now, these cards that you get a month early are cosmetics that you can unlock yourself.
Yeah, so it's not actually new cards.
No. You can always unlock the cards just naturally by playing the game.
Right, okay.
Even if you lose, you're still building up your collection level, which is your level, basically. I'm currently on level... 512.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I'm on 18, so there's a difference.
Yeah. I to play the game, I compare it mainly to Gwent. If you're a big Gwent fan and you get addicted to Gwent quite easily, stay back. this is Gwent on speed. Each match takes about 3 minutes. So... Someone like me, ADHD, riddled.
Yeah, I was going to say, perfect. It's going to hit all those tiny little dopamine receptors in the back of your head, doesn't it?
Oh, God.
Bright, flashy colours, levels going
on. Comics that I love.
Numbers.
Like I was telling you guys in the Discord that the art style, the default art style is my favourite art style in it. Everything that you have to pay for is fucking shite.
It's
awful.
They look rubbish. They really do.
They look rubbish. But like, all the whales
like
and the
Fortnite
kids.
Fortnite characters.
Yeah, I know. So stick with the default ones. Spend no money, guys. Spend no money. And the best thing about the game is, for people like me that need that little dopamine hit, there's missions, daily missions. And the missions are simple, like play more one-tier cards or play more two-tier cards. And what that does, the missions are slightly tutorializing the actual game. It makes you change your deck up. And the fact that it's only a 12-card deck, you're not there. Like when I was playing Hearthstone and certain other card games, you're shitting yourself, like, am I in the meta? Am I doing this right? Am I wasting a slot for this card and that card? 12 is so easy to handle.
So it's kind of closer to Gwent than like
Hearthstone
and Magic the Gathering. You have like 40 plus card decks.
Yeah, which is the variables are astronomical on that, aren't they? And I think there's only like I think there might be 100 cards that exist because they do it in phases. Do you get it? Phases. So we're on to phase two now. So there's only like 50 to 100 cards that exist. So what you have to do then when you PvP, because it's completely PvP, random PvP at the moment. You can't choose who to fight. Everyone's got the same cards. So it's all about being tactical, being fast. You can't, like all card games, you've got about 30 seconds to decide, so you can't cheat. I think it's perfect, and it's bang up there for game of the year for me. Unless a certain game that drops, I'll have it today. When by the time you're listening to this, isn't as good. Basically, it's it's just. I'm glad you've tried it, Biggie. When I first I only played it a few times a day. Now it's any time I can just pick my phone up. It's ridiculous.
I really don't play games on my phone anymore. And it was only because you were waffling on about it. Obviously, it's Marvel-based.
I weren't waffling.
A little look. And I had a little play with it. And yeah, it's really cool. I like it. It's really cool how you can, like he says, you can learn from what the game promotes to you, or just from the actual battles themselves. Somebody dropped Mr. Fantastic card, and if you drop it in the middle,
it punches the other realm,
both sides. Yeah, and it just, and I was like, oh god, that's really cool. And if you have characters that know each other, like obviously in the Avengers or Guardians of the Galaxy,
they all
have
a
little conversation with little balloons will pop up. It's just little bits of attention to detail. Just like it.
And the best thing
I'll
play
all day, but
pick
up and play, definitely.
It might end up being, mate, if you carry on. The best thing about it is like each of the three zones that you've got to win. You only have to win two out of three, obviously.
Yeah.
But they change as well. They have variables, so it might be. You can't put another card down. So if you've put a card down early and it's low, you've lost that zone. Do you know what I mean? It's so fucking clever.
Simple, isn't it? But
it's so simple,
tactically clever.
Yeah. I mean, it's called Marvel Snap. At first, I thought it was Snap, like the card game we used to play when we were kids.
I did too.
That's what I thought when you said what it was called.
Nothing to do with that. Nothing to do with that at all. It's just another competitor to the collectible card game genre. But I honestly, and on art, think it's the best one ever made. I don't think another game touches it. Just on sheer ease of
the relevance
play
of the snap. There's a cosmic cube at the top.
Yeah,
of
you
the,
can gamble
the screen, and you can gamble to sort of if you think you're basically going to win the match, you've got like a perfect deck.
You get more
gamble
experience.
To get more.
Yeah, but if you lose that gamble, you lose what you've gambled. So it's got the gambling addiction as well. But it's not.
Oh, you're
it's
fucked.
Not money. It's not money, though. You know what I mean? It's just time. That's all you're wasting time. But again, the other thing I do love about it, the fact that it's on iOS, it's on Android, and it's on Steam. Your progress just carries over without even thinking about it. So wherever you are, you can play it. You can have the iPad up downstairs. You can have your computer and then your phone as well. You can always just be playing it. It's exquisite. If you've got any interest in this, if you've played Gwent, especially Gwent, just give it a try. It's free as fuck. Just play it. Just play it. Please. I don't want to be on my own. But yes, let's move on to Stig.
Hello, that's me.
Hi.
Right. A couple of things this week. First up, I watched this 80s classic starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. Called Commando. You may have heard of it. You may have talked about it.
Never heard of it.
I had to watch it. I was the other night. I was like, it was like midnight. And I was like, just fancy watching this. Just stuck it on Disney. It's on Disney Plus. So it's like,
it's not even a long film, is it?
Nah, 90 minutes. It's so much fun. Loved it. The main thing I've watched this week is The Woman King. So this is directed by Gina Prince Blythewood, and it stars Viola Davis, Lashana Lynch, John Boyega, and Tuso and Bidu. I'm sorry if I get that wrong. And it's the story of the Agoji, the only female unit of warriors who protected the African kingdom of Dahomey in the 1800s with their skills and fierceness unlike anything the world has ever seen. So I think basically the Dora Milaje from Black Panther. It's what they're based on, pretty much. And it centers around General Naniska as she trains up the next generation of recruits and readies them for battle. Before I talk about this, I am well aware of the controversy surrounding this first.
Yeah.
And I will address that, but I want to speak on other things first. So I'm going to talk about the film, and then I'll talk about my thoughts afterwards.
Okay.
First and foremost, the best way to watch this film is to view it as a work of fiction. Because that's basically what it is. Taking aspects from history and making a story up with it. So
glamorized, isn't it?
I'll go into that again after I've talked about the film. Outside of that, really, this film is excellent. Like, if you just look at this as a film, as a work of fiction, as a story, taking inspiration from these women warriors and then making a story up about them, it's phenomenal. It's gorgeous. The set designs and costumes are amazing. The cinematography is fantastic, and the performances are just unreal. Viola Davis is just absolutely spectacular.
She's great anyway.
She's 57 years old.
She's not looking
it. When you see her in this film, age means fuck all. This is a woman that if I was fighting her, I would, this woman's going to fuck me up. Like, she's so powerful and commanding in this film. Like, she's absolutely amazing. Like, it's one of those ones where I'm not watching Viola Davis here. I'm watching
the character,
like full on. Like, I'm engrossed with the character here. She is probably 100% going to get an Oscar nod, and probably right now the front runner to win it. That Shana Lynch is also very good in this. Like, all the women are like complete badasses in this, but she offers like a little lightheartedness, bit of sarcasm, and a bit of comedy at times. Like, she has a really, really good chemistry with Tuso and Bidu. Like, them two play off each other really, really well. The fight scenes are amazing, so well choreographed. If not a little bit too modern, do you know what I mean? It's clearly taking inspiration from some modern films, from maybe the likes of like your Marvels and that, with some of the kind of flippity-do stuff and that. But it really works. It makes the women just look incredible. And like, from what I understand as well, like, a lot of the actors did a lot of this fighting themselves too. So like, which really pays off when you watch it. Like, you kind of applaud them for that, because they just look amazing. And at no point do you watch this and think that the tribe of men that they're fighting have advantage on them. Yeah, at no point, because just the way that they carry themselves, the choreography of the fighting, the way that everything about them just presents like this, like, you would be scared to fight these women in battle. Yeah. Like, they look amazing. So like, the whole film, it just packs a punch, whether it's the performances, like the emotional beats, the fighting, it's just really well crafted and put together extremely well. That's the film.
Yes, like, now.
Take that as a film. It's incredible. Onto the controversy. If you don't know the controversy surrounding this, the problem is that Hollywood has basically decided to take the Agoji and the Homi tribe and romanticize them and make them heroes. And
when they were brutalists.
Historically, they're anything but that. Yes. They were heavily involved in the slave trade. Gizo protested against the ending of it. And he did some unscrupulous and horrible things. And the film tries to paint them more and anti this.
They were the ones who were capturing people to be sold as slaves.
Yes.
They were one of them, but they were
big. White people.
They made their kingdom off the back of that. That's how they became so rich and powerful.
The original human trafficking, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
The film does address this. They do actually sit down at one point and discuss this and discuss how to move away from that. But as I've just described...
That never happened.
Well, no, because like I said, King Gizo didn't want it to end. And you do see a glimpse of them actually selling off prisoners at one point. That's about it. Outside of that, it's the other tribes and the French that are seen as the slavers. And they are...
I mean, they were.
The Homies. They are, but the film paints them as they're only the slavers and the Dahomian are the liberators. That is why you have to watch it as a work of fiction. You have to just take this as we've taken... What they would have been better off doing is if they'd have taken the Agoji women and used it as inspiration rather than say this
is
them.
Something fictitious.
Yeah, rather than say this is them, this is what happened, because that's not what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So outside that, I think my final thoughts on this is that I think as films like this, you wouldn't get these a few years ago. I think down to the success of stuff like Black Panther is that you now get in films, people want to see films about African stories and things like that. Like this film
is a celebration of that heritage.
Yeah, exactly. This film is directed by a black woman. It's written by two women. It features a predominantly black female cast. It's edited by a woman. It's produced mainly by women.
Good.
I think something like Black Panther, just because of the type of film it was and who it was catering for mainly, was like, that's kind of really helped these stories. And that's a good thing. Like, outside of the controversy, this is a step in the right direction. People are now willing to put money in production behind these kind of projects. It's just a shame that they twisted kind of what happened to make a more romanticized version of it. And again, it's a shame it's being review bombed on Metacritic.
Yeah.
But funnily enough, on Rotten Tomatoes, it isn't. That's usually Rotten Tomatoes, isn't it? But that's actually higher this time, and then the critics. Yeah. But on Metacritic, you should just see some of the comments. It's just like, they're just hiding behind, you can tell they're hiding behind the thin veil of historical accuracy.
They're hiding behind Wikipedia, mate. That's what they're hiding behind.
We know exactly why they are. You read them, there is misogynistic, racist, and anti-woke comments in there. They're pretending that they give a shit about historical accuracies, but you don't see any of them review bombing Braveheart.
Yeah, there's a separate agenda, isn't there?
Yeah, and one features a 99% black cast of warrior women, and one's white men. White men. It's really boring at this point.
It's dull.
If you watch the film and you have criticisms of the film and the storytelling and everything about that, and maybe the way that they've kind of glamorized
analysis rather than,
perfectly fine, give me a good reason. But when your reason is just like, this is woke propaganda and racist and stuff, it's just like, it's just so thin and obvious. So just
It's icky, isn't it?
Yeah, it's been well received. It's in my top 10 films of the year. If you can go into this film and kind of put all the shit to the side and just watch it, treat it as a work of fiction, then you'll really enjoy it. It's a really, really good film.
Yeah, and I mean, you can enjoy it guilt-free if you do your due diligence and research what really happened and stuff like that, and you understand. So regardless, it's like you say, it's a work of fiction.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it. Because I knew about all of it going into it.
Of course. This is what I was reading the other day, where someone said, it's absolutely Oscar worthy, but due to controversy, it probably won't.
I probably will, to be honest, knowing the buddy.
They do love a bit of controversy, don't they? They don't care, do they?
But it's nice to see a film. I know that there's, like, in the background of this, that it is the slave element in there, but it's nice to actually see a story set in Africa around that time that isn't just about someone being captured by the slave trade, sent to America, and then we watch them on plantations. There is more stories to be told from those from that culture and those times.
I agree, mate.
It isn't just that same old story. So it's good that we're kind of getting that, and that Hollywood actually has given them the money to do this.
Excellent.
Mention this second one. I watched Weird, the Al Yankovic story.
Very excited.
I just wanted to mention this one because I wanted to basically give my thoughts to Gadget about it, because I know he's a Weird Al fan.
Yes.
I'll start by saying,
apologist,
I'm not a Weird Al fan. I've already said this on the podcast. I don't find parody music funny. That's just not me. It's just something that's never clicked with me. I appreciate how clever he is, and I respect how he's managed to take that and make a career out of it. Like, I can completely get why people love it. It's just not for me.
Yeah.
The film, though, is just a wonderful parody of modern day music biopics.
Brilliant.
And it's really great to see them lampoon it in such a funny and outlandish way. I love parody films. Parody films is what gets me. Parody music doesn't. And I just love that Al treated his life this way to stay in tune with his character and act.
Yeah.
That this badass. This is my life story. It's like, this is a work. Like, again, this is a work of fiction.
He did say in an interview that I can't do just a biopic because my life is boring and normal.
It's so funny. 20 minutes in and I'd laughed like a dozen times at least. Daniel Radcliffe is absolutely fucking brilliant, and the stuff they do in this, it's just ripping into the likes of Bohemian Rhapsody. They tried to be so poor-faced and serious, and this just and
false
piss out of all of it. There's some real great cameos in this. There's a lot of characters, a lot of real people from the time of like the 70s and 80s, like Pee Wee Herman and Andy Warhol and that, they all turn up. There's a particular party where it just has all these characters and people from
they're all there at once.
Yeah, it just reminds me of that, you know, that Homer Simpson remembering what happened in the town hall meeting.
Yes.
Yeah. It reminds me of the narrator going, and at the party, this was there, this happened, that kind of thing. Yeah. Like, it's all bullshit, but everyone was there to see it happen, and everyone loved what happened, kind of thing. And
Weird Al's Middles in it as well as a cameo, isn't he?
Yeah, Weird Al plays in it. He's in it playing a
Doesn't
character.
He have quite a big role in it?
Yeah, yeah, he plays one of the music producers.
Yeah, I thought so.
But the middle section goes off from a biopic and turns more into a Naked Gun kind of film.
God.
But the payoff for it is fucking great. I was watching it going, this is a bit odd now. It's kind of losing its way, but like it brings it back. It really brings it back with a payoff, and it's great. And I just love watching Daniel Radcliffe do weird, outlandish shit.
And that's all he'll do for the rest of his life, and he can, because he's a billionaire.
Exactly. Doesn't need to do any kind of franchise or big studio film. It's just like, yeah, I'll do the weird Yankovic film, of course I will.
I've seen that. Yeah,
Gadget, you'll love it. I absolutely love it.
Definitely going to watch it this week. I saw an interview with Radcliffe. I think he was on Jimmy Fallon or something like that. He was saying, like, how do you perform as Weird Al? What kind of notes did he give you? He said, they were all on playing the accordion. He didn't care how I played him
as
long as I didn't look like I was bad at the accordion.
Which is notoriously one of the most difficult instruments to learn.
That Weird Al is a virtuoso at. One of like the world's
best. Insane.
I will be flabbergasted if you don't like this film. Honestly, yeah. If you don't
I've hoo-hawed laughed through the trailer, so I know I'm probably going to enjoy it.
Is it on par with stuff like, because I really liked Popstar and Dewey Cox? Is it like that?
I've seen people comparing it to Dewey Cox.
Oh, I love Dewey Cox so much. It's so funny.
I've not seen that.
Excellent. Oh, you need to, mate. Oh, you got to. And Popstar, that's Never Stopping, however it's called.
Yeah, that's great too.
So good.
A couple of things I'll mention in the green room after us.
Excellent. I've got some for that as well. Gadget, come on, finish me off. It's been a while.
It has been. So a couple of things. So obviously I wanted to talk about this last week, but couldn't because I was ill. But I played through Resident Evil Shadows of Rose, the DLC for Air Village.
Yes, good. I'm glad you're bringing this up, because I forgot that I'd beat it.
That's fucking excellent.
It's good, isn't it?
Yeah. So Shadows of Rose takes place kind of between the ending and the epilogue of Resident Evil 8.
It's an interquel, isn't it?
Yeah, weirdly. You play as Ethan Winter's daughter. It's 16 years after the events of Village. She's grown up, she has powers, she's kind of ostracized by her friends and by polite society because she's a freak and a weirdo because she has powers.
And she sweats white liquid.
Yeah. which is weird. So she is basically on a quest that takes her back to the world of Resident Evil Village to get rid of her powers. And that's kind of all I'll kind of say on the story for it. It's about 2.5 hours long. It's brilliant. It's really, really, I actually think it's the best part of Resident Evil Village.
Do you know what, mate? You can't argue with that.
There's only one bit of it that I thought let down the rest of it, which is the stealth section. I didn't like the stealth section as much as the rest of it.
Unless your game is predominantly a stealth game, don't put a stealth section in it. That's my advice.
Yeah, the enforced stealth section kind of felt a bit like Spider-Man PS4.
Let IO Interactive deal with the stealth. Mm.
But the rest of it is absolutely brilliant. You go back to Castle Dimitrescu, so you get to... Unfortunately, Lady D's not in it, but you do get to explore the castle, and because of the way Rose's powers work and the kind of the things that they set up there, the whole DLC is basically straddling areas you've seen before, but you're taking them on in a different way, and you're seeing from a different perspective. It's quite a nice way to reuse a lot of the assets that they already built.
It does what the main game does as well. It's a secret Metroidvania.
Yeah, yeah.
Kind of.
Huge puzzle box energy.
Yeah.
Which is what you want from Resident Evil. The puzzles aren't too intense either, but you're kind of working around. I went back to it and tried to do everything in a different order, and you can't. There's a very subtle hand pushing you in the right direction, but it doesn't feel like there is, which I quite like. Then once you're done with Castle Dimitrescu, you go somewhere else, which I'm not going to spoil, which gets very fucking scary, and is literally
the scariest Resident Evil moment I've experienced in my life.
Yeah,
and I've played them all.
It really does shit on Jack Baker, because like it makes me so much scarier than anything in Resident Evil 7.
Capcom could do a Silent Hill.
It's got such huge Silent Hill vibes.
They could easily do it.
And once you get past the stealth section, I genuinely think you have the scariest bit in the game. You know the bit I'm talking about where
Yep.
I'm not going to spoil it for people because I think I can say something for it which completely spoils it, but it's just so fucking good. Just play
don't
it.
Say anything. It's frightening. I still dream about it.
But no,
could have made a full
really
game
good.
On that bit,
Rose
though, couldn't
Winters
there?
Is a really good character. She is complete with the fact that she wants rid of the power. She kind of knows everything about kind of Umbrella and all the kind of events that led up to everything. So. She's aware of what's going on when she's in there. And there are some bits where it's really funny because she'll like just have little kind of cut lines of color dialogue, which she's just so fucking done with it.
Like, she's done with it, man.
There's one of the puzzles, you're putting things down, it makes a creepy noise, and she goes, yeah, ha ha, fuck you. And it's like
she says stuff like when you've done it, she goes, who puts puzzles here?
She's a really engaging character. This? I really like her. And it is the most definite end to the Winter's story. I really enjoy the way it ends. Didn't like the last boss so much, but it's fine.
I really did.
I mean, it's not bad. I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just saying it was just
yeah.
But no, it's really good. Shadows of the Rose is fantastic. And it's £16. If you enjoy Resident Evil 8, just fucking play it. It's really good. It's cheap.
And again, it's £16, not just for that, because I'm going to touch on you get the third person mode on the original Resident Evil, which is actually quite good, because I've played a lot of it.
I haven't done that yet. I haven't had time to get to it.
It makes the game completely different. It's more strategic. You can look around corners, things like that. It completely changes it up a little bit. But the main thing I've been playing on that is the mercenaries.
How's it good?
Playing as Heisenberg and Lady Dimitrescu. That's a game changer, mate.
Ah, nice.
And I played Reverse, which you get if you didn't already get it.
I've got it downloaded. I haven't played it yet. I've heard it's pretty good.
Reverse is good. It's only got two maps at the moment, but they're committed to it, apparently.
Fantastic.
Reverse is just... It's a different beast altogether. I'm not going into it now.
Yeah.
But it's a good package for £16.
Ooh. Well, everything's coming up Capcom then. But yeah, I'm really happy with Shadows of Rose. Play it. Just play it.
Yeah.
The main thing I want to talk about is I've been playing a game I've got a code for to review. This is a game called Oakenfold.
What is this?
So this is, I'm on the its Kickstarter page. It's a Kickstarter game. It's a solo dev game. One guy built it. And it's described as a clever time reversible strategy game. So,
okay.
This is made by a guy called Rutger van Dijk. And it is very much inspired by Into the Breach, to the point where if you look up a screenshot of it, it looks like Into the Breach.
Now you have my attention.
It is Into the Breach. It's identical. The difference is you play as a single character rather than having like a squad of guys around you. But it's the same basic gameplay concept where you've got these alien things that I think they call biocides, which are wrecking the planet, and you have to basically stop them from damaging infrastructure, damaging supply crates, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
It is a roguelike as well, so the you get heavily inspired by Slay the Spire. Because the map is the same as the Slay the Spire map, where you get like kind of lines, or the map in Inscription, you know, that kind of thing, where you get paths that you follow down.
Piquing my interest massively now, mate. You're speaking my language.
But it does these things based on these two games very similarly in terms of like when I was first playing, I was thinking, is there a reason to play this over into the Breach? But then I got into the
tough one.
I got into the time reversing thing. So what you get is you get each of your turns, you get 12 moves. Mm-hmm. And that includes like, moving squares, doing actions, attacks, that kind of thing. You get like kind of three kind of hotkey attacks. That's either like the one's a ranged one, one's a close up one, one's a moving one. So, you know, move things out of the way. Before the end of your turn, if you fuck something up or you realize your strategy is not going to work, you can roll back all those 12 steps at the beginning of your turn.
Oh. Like, what's that square game? Was it a Final Fantasy game that had that? Or was it one of their spin-offs where you could reverse it? Like a Bravely Default type game, one of those.
You
could move it back, but you could only do it a certain amount of times, couldn't
you? But it's basically that. So you can go back to the beginning of your turn, and everything on the map is affected by that. But if you are clever with things, you can bank that spare time to go into a currency for upgrades.
Yeah.
So if you think, I've done 5 moves here, I've got another 7 I can do, but I'm in a good place for the next turn, skip the next turn, that becomes then a resource for you.
Risk, reward.
Yeah, and I think that's what kind of separates it from Into the Breach. Into the Breach is great, and it's one of the best games ever made.
Stunning.
Yeah, and this game is taking that formula and doing it well, but this time mechanic is actually really interesting, and the more I played with it, the more I grew to like it and got interested in this mechanic, because if you just play it just as read, you will just sit and think, I could just play Into the Breach. But when you engage with this time mechanic, you can kind of scroll back and forth, because you can also like scroll forward to where you got to as well, if you think that you're... new idea isn't going to work.
Oh,
you
badass.
Can go back to it. So it's got a nice vibe. It doesn't really have much of a story. The whole thing is the world's being affected by these alien biocide things. You've got to get to the Oakenfold, which is a colony ship that will take you up to space. That's it. So you go through multiple levels. But yeah, I like it a lot, actually. It plays really well on the Steam Deck. In fact, that's entirely where I've been playing it.
You got a code for this, yeah?
Yeah, I got a code for it, yeah.
How much is it?
I don't think it'll be much. It comes out on the 17th of November. Hang on, I'll see if I can find the Steam page for
it. Is it in that cheap bangers category? Is it in a cheap bangers category? Come on.
I think it's going to be.
Ooh.
Shit,
no. £20, I'm in.
There's no price on the Steam page. There is a demo available on Steam.
If it's less than £20, it's in the cheap bangers category.
Given that it's a solo dev and it was a Kickstarter game, I don't think it's going to be expensive. To get a copy of the game, on the Kickstarter was €25, so it's probably going to be a £20 game.
That's fine. It counts.
Yeah. No. It's good. And if you look up the art style, it's got a really nice art style. And again, what is most impressive is that this is a solo dev. I think he paid a guy to do the music, but other than that, it's one guy doing the whole thing. You have three kind of character archetypes you can go through. This character you play is called Asher. You can go on, which is more based on survival, which is about keeping enemies at range and trying not to get damaged. You can do Agile, which is about quick movement and they're getting in, doing damage and getting out. And then the Scientific, which is tech. So
cool.
It's good, and I hope that it's something that comes out and he gets a lot of praise for it, and then he...
What's it called? Oakensnarl.
Oh no, that's a character in D&D. Oakenfold.
Oakenfold. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, you know, like the DJ.
Yeah, exactly.
Oakensnarl's niece not be very happy.
No.
Oh God.
Yeah, so that comes out on the 17th of November, and I mean, given there is a free demo on Steam as well, I would recommend having a try of it and seeing if it suits you.
I'm gonna.
But yeah, I think it's got a lot of potential, the more I've thought on it.
The problem is, I'll download the demo, but do you know what else is on Steam? Marvel Snap!
We need to put put a block on your computer for that.
Mate, I've not stopped! Let's move on to the main topic. I've been looking forward to this, actually, because I love the 80s. So, yeah, we're going to do it's simple, this one. Our favourite things that have come from the 80s. It's such a simple concept. Why have we never thought of it?
Because we're idiots.
The person who remembers the 80s more than anyone else here would be Biggie. Because he was born in the 40s.
Fuck.
Tell me, what's your favourite thing that came from the 80s, apart from your retirement?
Cocaine.
Unbelievable.
Cocaine. Oh, I've got to pick that.
There are only two sections of any catalogue that has ever excited me. One was the lingerie section, the other, of course, was the toys and games one in Argos.
Oh,
in the days before,
yes.
In the days before the internet, you had to get your fix from waiting for that bad motherfucker Bible-sized edition that had page after page after page of toys.
Oh,
whether they were based on the latest movie, TV series, or cartoon, or the biggest in brand names, they were generally reasonably priced with a neat little description underneath. You know, everything a kid or a parent needed to see for shopping for Christmas. If it wasn't in Argos, it just wasn't available.
Yeah.
Saturday morning cartoons or other big events, some of the fondest memories I've had as a child. He-Man, Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles. I hated that name. Why couldn't they be called ninjas?
Ninjas are evil. You know this.
Knight Rider, A-Team, Rambo, you name it. Pac-Land, the list goes on. The world of film was also responsible for emptying the wallets with companies like Kenner, who had the exclusive rights to produce toys based on the Star Wars films. Almost every character from the movie was present, even those that had screen time of just seconds. The look of the toys weren't particularly realistic at times, and the type of scans that you can obviously get today, but your imagination filled in the blanks.
That Luke Skywalker where the lightsaber came out of his arm.
Honestly, even compared to when we were kids, even in the 90s, like you look at the toys they have now, and it's
shite.
The toys now are incredible. What we used to get was like lots of plastic with like someone just drawn a smiley face on with a marker pen.
And the faces were the same. If you look at like Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, etc., they were the same character basically, just with different paint.
Good times.
If it wasn't just the figures that you wanted, but you got vehicles too, whether it was the speeder bikes to TIE fighters or the Rebel transporters to the Millennium Falcon, if you were fortunate enough.
Ecto-1.
You could go all out on the bases too. Who didn't want the Death Star? The Cat's Lair from Thundercats, or my favourite, Castle Grayskull.
No love for Tracy Island.
I had it. No, I made my own.
Oh, you did the little Blue Peter thing, did you?
Blue Peter, yeah.
Yeah.
Good, it. And for your Turner.
Whether you had Mask, which was sort of based on sort of the army, but had that little influence of the Transformers, or GoBots was the Japanese-inspired version, with humans pilotting the mechs, but also with Transformers, nothing really beat the Transformers. Mm-hmm. The toys were either inspired the cartoons or vice versa, all designed to make that money.
Yeah, it America, would definitely vice versa.
America would lead the way with this as well, because once the popularity of any new toy made it to the UK, parents would queue and even fight to get to the latest toys off the shelves to keep their kids happy. Don't know if you remember the days of the Teddy Ruxpins, Cabbage Patch Dolls, to mention a few.
No, but we were old enough to remember the Teletubbies.
I was old enough to remember the Toy Story.
The Toy Story, getting a buzz.
Trying to get a Buzz Lightyear. No
get
chance.
The Turbo Man!
It was like Turbo Man, it was basically like...
It what?
Like jingle all the way to trying to get all of the Buzz Lightyear. It's like,
I got one. Me, I got one in. I absolutely adored my Buzz Lightyear.
So expensive as well, weren't they?
Massive and all. Big old doll.
Happened even earlier because I remember when it was the Turtle Mania and he
couldn't get the Pterodrome or whatever we're called.
Couldn't get any of them in this country. I remember my mother telling us I got for Christmas 1991. I got a full set of the turtle figures. Only because my uncle was in the Navy and he happened to see them in Denmark.
Shit.
When he was a son shore leave.
Jammy gay. I only had Splinter and April.
The characters nobody wanted.
Yeah, that's all I had.
I think I had all of them.
Nobody likes you, Booster.
I do remember the toys. The toys coming out of the 80s, like from the actual characters, like the Turtles and the real Ghostbusters.
I had every real Ghostbusters one, Egon one where his mouth opened.
Yeah, yeah. I had
the A-Team, including the...
Oh, I'm too young for the A-Team dolls, mate.
Oh, mate, they were awesome. But whatever you're into, there was something for everyone. It could have been board games. You had things like Buckaroo, Mousetrap, Operation. You had the Ball Stephen Hawking Simulator, Speak and Spell. There's Simon, Etch-a-Sketch. There was just something for everyone. And then you had the 80s gaming boom as well.
That was one of my favorite things. You talk about like looking through the Argos catalog. One of my favorite things was like looking through that and like seeing what games were in there now and what accessories.
Big
and...
Mega Drive splash screen, splash page.
Yeah, like, what's in there now and what's new. Like, it's one of the ways to know like what was new.
Just a quick tangent on that with the Argos. We got an Argos catalog over week and it's just got a massive Fortnite V-book page now. It's awful. It's not what you want to see.
They're also like only they're dead thin now, aren't they? Only like a couple of hundred pages.
Oh, they're tiny. Yeah. And every time you go on something that's like, for more, scan this QR code and see it on your phone. It's like, no, it's not the same.
Do you remember the pallets when you go into Argos of just all the catalogues
there? Mate, in our house...
They're free as well to take.
My nana used to ring landline guys, younger listeners, and say, right, I'm outside Argos, how many do you want? My mum would be like, four! Get four catalogues. One for every room.
Your poor nana's having to drag them through the streets.
No, bless her, I know. Jenny had one of them trolleys.
Yeah, you had the consoles, whether it was Sega Genesis or an Atari 2600 or the original NES, or if you're into computers, you had the Commodore 64, your Spectrums and your Apples. But yeah, fond memories of the 80s always reminds me of the toys that I used to love.
Yeah, man. Good pick. I'm glad someone brought that up because, yeah, that's just, do you know when... That nostalgia that makes you smile rather than, oh, I hated that time. That's a good one. That's a good one. A simple tome of capitalism. I love it. I love it. Right, I'll do this next bit. So, the most impactful moment in world history happened in the 80s. When this event happened, the world stopped. You could hear a pin drop. 5 billion people then raised their fist into the air and rejoiced at the apex of human endeavour, taste and wonder. That moment was my birth. But we're not talking about that.
boo.
You weren't... Well, you were there, actually. Yeah, I'm youngest, aren't I? So...
I was there.
Joking.
He's the dad.
Obviously. What? Dad! Mate, you'd have been about fucking nine when I were born.
Top shagger, biggie.
I got those fags.
Top shagger. Absolute top shagger. Yeah, for me, my favourite thing about the 80s was the music. To the point where I would die on the hill that states that the 80s is the best decade of music since cavemen started banging sticks together 80,000 years ago. Popular music today is simply dull and unoriginal.
Great. We're going to get a middle-aged man rant going on here.
Oh, yeah. Unoriginal. But the 80s had every genre covered, from psychedelic jazz fusion albums to the birth of thrash metal. Everything had its place. But the king/queen genre of music in the 80s was pop music and the new romantic movement. Oh, my God. So we're talking Duran Duran, Flock of Seagulls, Madonna, Pet Shop Boys, Tears for Fears, The Cure, Culture Club, Spandau Ballet, Depeche Mode, and the change of acts from the 70s that morphed into the 80s with aplomb, in my opinion, like Elton John, David Bowie, Genesis, Queen, Ozzy Osbourne even had his 80s moment. Do you know what I mean? Everyone changed for that decade, and for the better in a lot of places. So, like, everyone was having fun and trying to spread love and joy in a decade filled with political strife and uncertainty. The fashion that went along with the music scenes were also top tier. Like, to the point where I wish I were born in the late 60s so I could have been a teenager in the 80s, like Biggie. But instead, I was a teenager in the noughties, dominated by fucking Limp Bizkit and Nickelback. Do you know what I mean? It's not fucking fair. It's not fair.
To be fair, there was a lot of shit music out in the 80s.
Like, No.
Because we remember the hits. We remember the stuff that got to the top of the charts that was heavily marketed. Think about how much music is released now. Scale it down slightly, but the 80s were a time of massive investment in the music industry. Everyone was looking for the next big hit. Yeah. There was so much shit released.
There was a lot of one-hit wonders, weren't there?
A lot of non-hit wonders
Stock,
as well.
Aitken and Waterman, my time.
Yeah.
A lot of those. But one-hit wonders, a lot of them are in this. They're pushed into one bracket of power ballads. An 80s power ballad is like nothing you've ever heard of before or what we've had since. They're all the power ballads are like in the 80s. You don't really get them in the 70s or the 90s, and they're fucking incredible.
Yeah, you've got like Scorpions, Roxette, and things like, you know what I mean? These absolute mammoth songs.
Bonnie Tyler.
Oh, God. Oh, yes, absolutely. Like, nothing hits like those bangers. Like, then again, like, the a main thing from in my life is the birth of when, it's not the birth of metal, but it's when thrash metal came into the scene, and they were like, oh, we can be heavier, we can be faster, we can be better at our instruments, because metal were invented for people that couldn't play guitar. We all know this. But it got better. And do you know what I mean? I just think there's something about it. And to this day, I think rock music still latches onto that kind of era, scene, if you get what I mean. It's still, it's obviously modern, but it's still from that decade or genus, if you want. But yeah, everything about 80s music, the fashion, even the shoulder pads, man, I'm all about that shit.
That's because you've got tiny shoulders and you want to feel like a grown-up boy.
Yeah, absolutely. I've always loved it. And a decade that I'd barely spent any time in, do you know what I mean? But it still resonates with me 30-odd years later.
I think I mentioned before, Bruno Brooks on a Sunday evening used to do the top 40 countdown for 2 hours or 3 hours, whatever it was. And I used to religiously sit there.
I had a play on that of the script at the beginning of the show, if you didn't notice.
And I used to do a tape recorder and just tape all the music.
Yeah. And stop it when he started talking.
Yep.
Yeah, me and my sister did that. It was just good times. Like, to finish off my little love for the 80s music, I've got three fun facts. Man, they're not fun. My facts are never fun about 80s music, but they're backed up. So the 80s holds the record for most covered and sampled songs by contemporary artists. This is what I'm saying. Modern day music's not original at all. It's got the most sampled songs. Also, pop music has never been as profitable since the 80s, according to Forbes magazine. Like Gadget says, a lot of investment went in. reaped benefits.
Yeah, it was also very expensive to make music back then. Like, there's less investment in it now because it's so much cheaper.
Yeah, you can just drop up a SoundCloud album, right, for nothing.
Yeah.
That's crazy. And the popular MP3 music file format was finally finished and created in 1988. I didn't know that till today. That's mental, isn't it? It took so long for it to actually... it's about getting it out there and being cheap enough, isn't it?
Well, no.
What's MP stand for?
I don't know.
I don't know. I've been using them for years.
I think it's just a dot format, isn't it?
I think it's Media Player.
Mm, the third version.
MP3, the codec and the software was created then, but there was nothing to play on it.
Exactly. There's no player.
It's just a compression format. You need something to read it.
Yeah, exactly. But I just think substantially impactful decade of music and fashion, and I've always loved it.
I was well into pop music in the 80s then, and
because you were better.
But it has no reflection really on the music that I listen to today. It's just, you know, a massive gap between what I listened to then and what I listen to now. But my birth in music was during the 80s. That's when
doesn't that prove that it's never been as good as then? You know what I mean? You don't like pop music anymore.
No, but I do kind of agree with the pop music side. I don't think there's been a better era since the 80s.
There hasn't.
I grew up in 90s pop music and bleeding slightly into 2000s. Mm. But if I was going to listen to some pop music, I'd go back and listen to 80s. I'd listen to stuff like Erasure and things like that. Like,
yeah, you want some synth, don't you?
It's so much better. Honestly, it is. That's the thing. The more fun. Like, I literally just gone on to Spotify here now, talking power ballads, 80s power ballads. Like, Here I Go Again. Jesse's Girl, Free Falling, Eye of the Tiger, Since You've Been Gone, Don't Stop Believing. I know that's overplayed now because of Glee, but before that, was Africa, Total Eclipse of the Heart, More Than a Feeling. And these are absolute bangers.
Huge.
And absolute timeless as well. Burning Heart from Rocky Five. Yeah. Fucking love that shit. Absolutely love it.
Absolutely, mate. Pop music has never been the same, and I don't think it ever will. I think that's it. Pop music's over. It's all about genre music now, and it's a shame. But yeah, that's my pick. Stig, what are you bringing?
I am going to bring something else which I don't think has been better since the 80s. And it's interesting that... no, it's definitely better. No, I just find it funny that three of us only kind of had a few years in the 80s.
Yeah, barely remember it.
But we can go, we'll go back and we've watched things from that time and knew and enjoy them. And I want to talk about comedies. 80s comedies. Because we talked about action films last week. If we hadn't done action films last week, I probably would have talked action films. Because for me, again, it's just, I kind of love those over-the-top, cheesy like action films that you get with Schwarzenegger.
Decade of Excess.
And Van Damme and those kind of things. But I also think on the flip side, you've got that with comedies as well.
Mm-hmm.
That most comedy classics probably come from, that a lot of people remember, come from 70s and a lot into the 80s, especially around our age, is we remember the ones from the 80s. So you have the likes of Blues Brothers, Back to the Future, Ghostbusters, the Burbs, Clue, Coming to America. Planes, Trains, Automobiles, Beverly Hills Cop. Like, they're all ones that you know of, and you know the characters in them.
Yeah.
So that's the important thing to me. Like, there are great comedies now, but how many times can you remember the... Like, I love Game
Night. Don't know the names.
Can't remember a single character from them at all.
Nope.
But I do remember the characters in these 80s films. And the best thing about the comedies in the 80s was the... bled into other genres as well. So not only did you just have like your standard comedies, you then had kind of sci-fi comedies. So Bill and Ted or Little Shop of Horror, Critters was also like a sci-fi horror comedy.
Gremlins.
You had martial arts comedies. I'm sure Biggie's probably seen some of these as well. Police Story's a bit of a martial arts comedy, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it just kind of... they had so many different genres that you could fit into it. You had comedy, buddy cop comedies. So
like Lethal Weapon.
Yeah, Lethal Weapon.
Which is also comedy / drama / crime procedural / everything else.
Yeah, like maybe not buddy cop, like that's the kind of generic term, but like friendship comedy. So Stripes, Hear No Evil, See No Evil, Turner and Hooch, Police Academy, Weekend at Bernie's. Like you might not love these films, but you know of them because some they are big, like well-known comedies. Everyone kind of knows of them, and everyone's
and like the road trip comedies as well. That started, didn't it?
Yeah. So Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. God, what's the other one
Cannonball.
Called? Yeah, and Midnight Run is a great one. That's another buddy comedy film. Twins, Tango Cash. I'm just sat here naming these films, but you've all heard of them, and majority of people will have seen them and will enjoy them. And I just think it there's a lot of big stars as well that you remember from that age. You know,
what you do notice is, like you were saying earlier, there's good comedies and stuff now, but you remember even now you'll say, Game Night. That actor is good in it. But in like the 80s ones, you're like, oh God, Turner in Turner and Hooch, love him. Rather than you don't say Tom Hanks, do you? You say the character's name. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, like
you remember the character.
Axel Foley rather than Eddie Murphy.
You'll say Axel Foley every single time.
But the point is that Eddie Murphy is like a huge comedy star that you have. Eddie Murphy likes a Steve Martin, Danny DeVito, you have as much of a dickhead as he is, Chevy Chase, you have Dan Aykroyd, Bill Murray, John Candy. These are huge comedy stars who, came from the 80s predominantly. That's where they made it big in the 80s. And there are so many great 80s films that I could just go back and enjoy over and over again.
You know what most of those stars have in common? Saturday Night Live.
Cocaine.
I was going to say cocaine.
So 80s Saturday Night Live.
Yeah, they're like, from that, aren't they?
Was ridiculous, because you also had Jim Belushi, you had Chris Farley, you had all these people that came out of
it. It was the biggest thing ever, wasn't it?
It was. And they created that they were these high profile comedians who were good writers and great performers, who then got high budget comedy films. Whereas a lot of comedy films that you get nowadays tend to be low budget and very disposable, very quick comedies to make and very kind of by the numbers. So you don't remember them as much.
I agree, mate. I absolutely agree.
Whereas in the 80s, comedy films tended to get a bit bigger budget and a bit more prestige about
them.
Because
it was hard.
Yeah.
It got people in the cinemas. I can't remember the last time I went to the cinema to watch a comedy film. You go to see an event film, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm off to see I'm trying to think of a comedy actor now. I'm off to see Adam Sandler's new film. I mean, I'd never say that anyway, but you know what I mean?
There's your example from the modern time. Like Adam Sandler has made it's like a production line of comedy films in his style.
Yeah.
Which is how you end up with Grown Ups 2, because it's the same formula, or like The Ridiculous 6, or, you know, the kind of the shit that he did for Netflix.
And
it becomes very commodified and very cheap to make and very low budget.
Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. There's so much heart in it.
Oh, it's incredible. Yeah.
There's so much heart into it. And
one of my favorites.
I know there's
that rant is.
Oh, the rant is so good.
He says fuck 19 times in a minute.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But even though.
You get that rant, and then you get the payoff of just the look on John Candy's face. And it's heartbreaking.
the professionalism as well between two main stars, even if they didn't like each other, which a lot of them didn't like each other, the professionalism was there. They still put it through. Like, half of the Ghostbusters weren't talking by Ghostbusters 2. Do you know what I mean? It's just...
I think everyone hated Jim Belushi by the time they'd
worked
with
him. Oh, everyone did, because he was a horrible bastard. But, yeah, it's one of those things. But they still put that professionalism first, didn't they? And it's just... Oh,
yeah, the spoof comedies as well, didn't you?
So the spoof comedies, I've made a note here. I don't think there's no better era than spoof comedies. Airplane. No. Airplane 2 has got its moments. It's not as good.
Yep.
Yeah.
Was Airplane the 80s? I thought that was the 70s.
No, Airplane is the 80s.
1980.
Naked Gun, Top Secret, Spaceballs, Spinal Tap, Dead Men Don't Wear Plaid.
Spinal Tap.
It's just, I mean, Little Shop of Horrors is pretty much a spoof. Let's get it real. Like, there's a lot of problematic shit in 80s comedies.
Yes.
We know that.
Yep. Undeniably.
But outside of that, and I also think that because they had a bit more free reign, they are more enjoyable and more memorable.
I get what you're saying.
Like we can kind of look at some of the, you know, misogynistic stuff and at times racist stuff that just played for a joke.
Slurs that are just thrown out
without
any impact.
Stuff that it's just like, because it's seen as a comedy, like as a quick one-liner. But because they had a bit more freedom to do other stuff, it just makes them more enjoyable. Like, just kind of look at the Ghostbusters. These guys, like, they're schlubs. And they smoke.
And all they do on the first one is smoke. And every single scene, they've got a cig in the mouth.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but they feel way more relatable than...
Real.
Yeah, they feel real than the modern characters.
Those actors are smoking those cigs. They're not fake movie cigs. Yeah. They're having a cig.
There's just something about the kind of that era and the comedy.
And Ray got a blowjob from a ghost.
He did. Yeah, luckily when we watched that, like, Amelia didn't say anything. She just kind of I think she just took it as like his sheets moving, he's being haunted or something. Like,
yeah, she's tickling. I said it to my son. I went, "It's tickling his feet." He went, "Oh yeah, I understand." I went, mm-hmm.
Yeah, just the comedies from the '80s. There are so many classics and so many, like, I mean, I'm just looking at this list here as well. My favorites and within these 4-star films as well, you've got stuff like Who Framed Roger Rabbit, like that's you know, just things like that.
Genre bending.
It's like a meant to be a kid's film, but also slightly not. It's
dark as shit, that film. I love it. Yeah.
But... Oh, God, it's so good. I'm glad they didn't do a sequel to that. It's just this one, its own thing. Ooh. Roger Rabbit?
They didn't?
They've not done a Roger Rabbit 2, mate.
No, definitely not.
You're thinking of Space Jam 2.
Yeah, Roger Rabbit 2, the Toon Platoon.
No way.
No way. I've never heard of this.
When did this happen? When did this happen? What year?
Oh, hang on. Unproduced prequel to the critically acclaimed film follows Roger Rabbit learning he's adopted, going out to search for his birth mother. The script takes place from 1941 to 1943.
It's not released then.
Apparently there was meant to be one released this year.
Oh no. Oh no. What have we done? We've cursed Roger Rabbit.
Sorry for bringing it up. Yeah, just again, just the comedies, man. The ability to spread across different genres and still be hilarious, even though it's a completely different film. You're watching a horror here, but it's still got this amazing comedy elements.
I just think
it's unrivaled. I mean, I've missed Robin Williams here as well when I was listing off actors. I'm just looking through this list here, man. He was amazing as well. But
he was.
Yeah, 80s comedies, incredible. And these are the kind of things, these 80s films are the kind of stuff that I kind of show my daughter. You know,
the comfort films, aren't they?
When she gets a bit older, obviously we'll get onto the more adult comedies, but you know, things like Monster Squad and Princess Bride and stuff like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, like they're all fine for her. She enjoys them.
Yeah. Good, good pull. Gadget.
So I want to talk about tech that came out in the 80s, and there's actually two things I precisely want to talk about. First one is the Apple Macintosh. So this is, everyone knows what this looks like. It's a little beige box with a keyboard and a mouse. It's an ugly little thing. But it wasn't at the time. It was the first of
then
its kind.
Then it wasn't, no. Yeah. They were like, whoa.
But what is important about this particular computer is this was the first computer that hit the mainstream that had a graphical user interface and a mouse. So
really?
Yep, and it came out in 1984. Previously, all computers up to this point that you have at home, so whether it was the Apple I, the Apple II, or any IBM machine, or Spectrum, or a Commodore, whatever, you interacted with it in command line. So, you know, you type your file structure, CD, games.
Of course you'd play.
The games. Yeah, play, or cat, or whatever. You use them like old Linux boxes. So up to that point, there was no user interface. Like, different programs would have a user interface. Like, again, you would navigate around with keys and all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Steve Jobs did. I mean, to be fair, he ripped the idea off IBM. He'd seen something that IBM were making.
He ripped most of his ideas off.
He did, yeah.
That's how he got his millions.
Well, yeah, Steve Jobs was great at marketing. He was not so much the ideas. But he'd seen a tour of the IBM facility, the concept of a graphical user interface with a ruler ball to move a mouse around.
Oh, right.
And he charged the engineers at Apple with making it. And what they came up with was, instead of using a static ruler ball on your desk, was the humble mouse that we still use today. Back then it had a single button on it, but you had a graphical user interface which looks, for all intents and purposes, a lot like Mac OS X does today.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it?
So this was Mac OS One, it was ridiculously popular. It had that 1984 advert that Ridley Scott produced at the Super Bowl.
Where he's throwing the hammer.
The Think Different ad, and that encouraged people to buy it. It sold for, at the time, 1984. Oodles, hold on to your seat here. Your cheap Yorkshireman's going to take a hit.
Oh.
In 1984, it sold for $2,495.
Fuck off.
Which in 2021 would be $6,508.
It's still cheaper than the PSVR 2.
Yeah. It had a 9-inch black and white CRT monitor, a floppy drive.
So have I.
Its own keyboard and a mouse. That's all that came with it. It was all housed in beige plastic. And it had, where's the stats for what it had in it?
Are you sure it was beige plastic, or was it white that turned beige?
No, it was kind of an off beige that just got darker over time.
Oh, that's fine then.
It ran with a Motorola 68000 microprocessor running at a whopping 7.8 megahertz. Connected to 128 kilobytes of RAM. That's kilobytes, not megabytes.
Wow.
It was. I mean, to be fair, for the time, it wasn't the most powerful thing in the world, but it was unique, and it got it became a business thing. So Microsoft Excel was first written for this.
No way. Which because, I use every day.
Because it has a graphical user interface.
Yeah.
There had been spreadsheet software before, but Excel was written for this. It came with like kind of the progenitors for Photoshop and InDesign and stuff like that. So you had Mac Paint, you had Mac Design and software like that. And it was hideously popular. People loved it. It sold by the bucket load. It was still
even at that price.
Even at that price. I mean, it got cheaper over time. And then obviously there were redesigns for it. So like because Steve Jobs is Steve Jobs, for instance, he thought, no, this computer is everything that you need. All the innovation happens in software. So there was very little options for expansions. You had no kind of extra ports to put RAM in or anything like that. It was kind of a very limited to what you could do with it. It didn't have fans in it.
Was it just floppy disk?
It was just floppy disk, yeah. Didn't even have a hard drive.
Wow.
Until like later variations came along with hard drives and you could get expansions, more RAM into it. There were versions released with a fan because Steve Jobs didn't want the sound of a fan. He thought it was distracting from work, which caused a few fires.
Any controversy is good marketing. Yeah.
But ultimately, this took off with business and then it also took off at home. People started making games for it. And as various iterations came on, eventually in 1987, it became the SE, which is one of the more common ones that we know today. And then that kind of led down into the Power Mac and the kind of the G series. But Apple still supported the original 1984 Macintosh 128K until 1998.
That's insane.
14 years of support that computer had.
To be fair with Apple, they like to support their hardware, like the phones, for instance. This is the only manufacturer that can say that a six-year-old phone's still supported.
True, yeah. But it's just interesting because had Steve Jobs not nicked this idea from IBM, who knows where we'd be with computing? Like, we have a graphical user interface now in Windows so we can talk to each other over the internet.
I think without him, we'd have what the Nostromo has got today.
I've got a quick question around that.
Yeah.
Not being a PC gamer, so what happened with PC games and Macintosh, where my understanding was that people stopped developing or porting games to the Mac? It became like a really unpopular choice to convert games for the Mac, because everything ended up being PC in the end, wasn't it?
PC went huge, didn't it? That's why.
Well, back in those days, you had to define it as not PC, it was like Macintosh and IBM, because everything that we use now is based on IBM designs. Eventually, it got to the point where Macintosh, and it's the problem that Apple suffers still with now. They become so premium and so kind of focused on their own thing, whereas the
mass market is it?
It is mass market because they're very popular, but the PC became very modular and very homebrew and do it yourself.
Nerds like them better, don't they?
Yeah, Steve Jobs didn't want people writing their own software. He wanted companies writing software for the Mac. Over time, it got harder and harder to make things for the Mac. Whereas, like people, the PC was always an open structure. Like you still to this day, you cannot buy a version of Mac OS that works on anything but Mac hardware.
Yeah, yeah.
And
it's because of Mac that I am technologically behind everyone else at my age, because when I were at school, do you know, you have the IT rooms.
Yeah.
We had like, I don't know, whatever amount of PCs. And my seat was where the only Mac was in the room. So I did loads of things on Mac. And I first ever touched a Windows computer when it was Windows ME. So I was so behind.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And everyone's like, it's easy to do. I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing. So I think that's why I'm behind. Plus, I'm just an idiot.
Yeah,
don't agree.
No, but yeah, you ended up in those days as well. If you started with a Mac, if you started with an Apple computer, you tended to stick with Apple computers. There wasn't a lot of cross.
I did for ages, because
when you had the Apple 1 and 2, and then like the early IBM PCs and the PET and stuff like that, you got very focused into how they worked. So you ended up staying within that infrastructure. Last thing I'll say on the Macintosh, well, there's a little cute little Easter egg with it. If you ever see one of the original ones and take the case off it, it's got the signatures of all the engineers who worked on it embossed into the case.
Oh, that's awesome.
which I think is just nice.
Cute, isn't it? It's cute.
But the other bit of technology I want to talk about is the humble Sony Walkman.
Yes. Machine. What a machine.
What a machine that is.
What a moment of engineering that is.
Take your tips with you.
Oof. Well, what? You mean I can jog and listen to music at the same time?
That's it, man. To making music portable. Like, compact cassettes have been around since the 60s up until that point, but Sony made this little... The thing is, I love how they look now. Like, the
sound.
I love that kind of vaporwave sound anyway. I love the sound of tape.
Yeah.
But, like, I love the way they look, these kind of blue and silver steel boxes.
Like red, orange earphones.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, yes.
But yeah, it was a revolution in the... When did they first come out? I think the first ones were... It came out in Japan in 1979.
Yeah. But it went global in the 80s.
Yeah, it went global in the 80s. And they're an icon of the 80s.
I had one. I loved it.
I had multiple Walkmans. I had a cassette one. I had the original CD Walkman. I had a mini disc one.
I had the original Walkman, the tape one, the blue and silver one, till 1998.
Nice.
I fucking adored it.
They
couldn't find tapes anymore.
Yeah. They are the ultimate in vintage cool. Like, especially if you get like a 79 or an 81. The revolutionary, being able to take your music with you. Like, previous to that, what did you have? Boom boxes that you had to broadcast to the entire street that you're walking up.
I mean, you do look cool with a boom box, but everyone hears it.
Everyone thinks you're a cunt.
You might have really bad taste of music.
I mean, imagine Noodles walking around Leeds with a fucking boombox on his shoulder, listening to Lorna Shaw. You get glassed.
Definitely not.
What people walk around now with this shit playing out of the phones, don't they?
It's like grime, innit? It's all that grime. Fuck off.
So the Walkman was one of the most popular pieces of technology ever released. They sold millions of the damn things. And the design never really changed on them that much. They were pretty much static as to what they were. They just looked cooler over the years as they kind of got on. They got a little thinner.
They
got rechargeable batteries. Ones with like inline remote controls.
Remember the re-release in the early 90s, the black one?
The black one. Oh, that was lovely.
Stunning. I had that one as well. Oh, God, I loved them.
Like, most people recognize Walkman now as more of a brand than as the actual original kind of cassette Walkman. But they were strong, they were well built, they sounded great. The headphones that you got were not the most expensive in the world. And not
you had to change them, didn't you? Get your own.
Yeah, you had to get your own headphones.
The
best one I had was the one that was almost the size of a tape. It got that small.
Yeah. Yes, they did, didn't they?
For the Walkman, it was just a little slide opening that you just slide the tape in and shut it. Perfect.
The noise. Oh.
That click, clunk, play.
Oh, God. Mm. That is ASMR, that.
Yeah. It's one of the things, because obviously I love my gadgets, I love my toys. And I think the Walkman and the Mac together, they kind of represent the two most important things in the world right now. Because music and computers. And, you know, the fact that you've got an iPhone, which does it all now in one little device. It's like
magic, innit?
These two progenitors to something that's become so important in 2022. So, I think it's one thing, if you've never held a proper Walkman, you've missed out, because I think there is something, they're icons, they're iconic.
The problem is now, if you've never had one, they're a lot more expensive than they used to be now. I've got one at my mum's, so if anyone wants to buy it, it's going to cost the same amount as if Sony PlayStation VR 2. I'll swap you.
let's have a look on eBay and see.
I were looking at some sealed ones. A few months, and we were talking about Walkmans a few months ago, weren't we? And I was looking at some sealed ones, and all the plastic's gone yellow, and they're going for like $4,000, mate.
1983 Sony Walkman WM4 cassette player, fully functional, in blue, £250. It's got 12 watches on it. Yeah, unbox and everything.
Wow.
Jesus Christ. Yeah, so hang on, can we filter by...
I mean, look at Sony Walkman now with their MP3 players. The dearest ones you can buy.
They're supposed to be really good, though, for sound, right?
Yeah, they're lossless quality, high def and stuff, aren't they? Oh, fuck now.
So, working... Sony Walkman WM20 Gold, limited edition, £2,800. One of the original ones from the 80s. This one has bids on it, £2,179.
How many bids you got on that?
Got two bids on it.
Have you been bidding?
I waste my money on a lot of things. Oh, here's the iconic blue and silver one. Sony WM3, refurbished, £903. That one's going to come from Japan.
Fucking hell.
I'd love to get my hands on another one of those original ones that I had.
Do you know what I've seen, Gadget? And it'll make a nice present from me to you, actually.
Yeah.
Is do you know how Gunpla is a thing? And I'm obsessed with it. And you, like my little PlayStations that you can make Gunpla ones.
Yeah.
I've seen the Sony Walkman one. Yeah. And you can sit there and build it yourself. I'll get, they're only 18 quid. It's the tax that you get them into country that costs more than the device.
Oh. What's it, a Walkman Gundam?
Yeah. Well, Gunpla. Gunpla. Not Gundam. It's not a robot.
Gundam.
I don't know.
I'll send you a link if you can't find it. It's, they're only in Japan, but... Oh,
yeah,
God,
send me a link because I kind of want something like that.
But, you sit and build it and all the innards.
Yeah, I love 80s tech. I love the style of it. There's a really great series on YouTube that Marcus Brownlee did called Retro Tech.
Yes,
where he's and that was kind of the inspiration for that because he did an episode on the Macintosh, he did an episode on the Walkman, and he's approaching 30, he's a person in his 20s, but he came to the internet later than we did because of his age, he's seeing a lot of this stuff for the first time now, and it's actually really quite lovely to see someone like playing with this stuff for
to
the
see
first
a
time.
Young and love it.
Yeah, but also kind of work out how to use it because they don't have the instruction manuals when he's playing with them. And it's like how intuitive 80s tech was because it had to be.
So I've got a Bush vinyl player, just a classic one, you know, that my stepdad gave me. A wooden, one that you have to varnish.
Ooh, nice.
And I played, what was it now? De La Soul. I had the vinyl of it and I put it down. My daughter's going, what are you doing? What is that? And I went, watch this. Put the needle on. And she went, music? And she was so astounded that music was coming out of it. I went,
Was grooving her heart.
I was polishing it. Oh, definitely. I was cleaning it with vinyl cleaner and stuff. And she's like, oh, that stinks. I went, don't get too close. Because that stuff, fuck you up.
Don't get too close.
I assume that was 3 feet high and rising.
Oh yeah. Oh God. But yeah, I think Walkman. I mean, as a like name, it's famous for the phone line that they did as well, the Sony Walkmans.
Yeah, the WA10i was the greatest phone I had for a very long time.
Fantastic bit of care. Just a good brand. Like I would love one of those 500 quid MP3 players, but then again, I wear skinny jeans. I can't have another device. Do you know what I mean? That's the problem. And I've got a phone. So it's a shame. It's a shame, innit? But yeah. Good picks from all. So, that was our little 80s retrospective. As always, links... Oh, no.
You're getting ahead of yourself. What are you doing?
Jeez, you're only off a week. Fucking hell, man.
Oh, my... Hey, I'm still a better host. Yeah, I want to know what everyone else has been... everyone else has been thinking back on, if there is at all.
Yeah, we have a few of them. King Hagrid has written in. Says, my personal highlights of the 80s are The Princess Bride, which was casually overlooked in the action movie episode.
Someone did mention it in the feedback, actually.
Yes.
Such a good film.
And With Neil and I, they are my two favourite films of all time.
Oh, With Neil and I is so fucking good. If you've never seen that, watch it. Richard E. Grant.
I find both films, as the kids would say, mid.
Oh, no, really?
Yep. I think they're both overrated.
I have never seen either.
Oh,
you'd probably like With Neil and I, actually.
You would.
Northern miserable, isn't it?
Yeah.
Lee Dean.
Yeah, I thought it was all right.
Lee Dean.
All right, there.
Catching up
You're
with
welcome.
The conversation there.
Put that on the box.
Lee Davies has said, music-wise, it's the Pet Shop Boys in Erasure. I love my synth-based pop duos. Movies, it's the Indiana Jones trilogy. Specifying.
Yes.
Trilogy.
Well, there's only a trilogy, isn't there?
There's only a trilogy. There's only three films.
I didn't know there was another one.
I mean, one of them is wildly racist, but you know. Games of the 80s is Super Mario Brothers. Also, I should mention Paradroid on the Commodore 64.
Played it. Yes. Loved it.
He goes on to say, it wasn't very fashionable in the 80s with... I wasn't very fashionable in the 80s with my council estate bowl cut.
I've got one now.
Yeah. I just remember everything being brown. I would have been 11 as we went into the 90s, and I feel like that was more my decade. The 80s didn't feel good to me at the time. It were pretty grim. It wasn't until Vice City came out that the 80s became cool for me. Oh, and on TV, yeah. Blackadder. Still good after all these years.
Yep. See, comedy, timeless.
Absolutely.
And last of us, Xenos saying, I think it's fair to say some of the best-known franchises in gaming history started in the 80s. Mario, The Legend of Zelda, the Metroid series have come a long way since then. But the first standalone Mario game was an arcade release in 1983, and all three franchises hit the NES later that decade. If you don't count Mario Brothers as the first Mario game, Donkey Kong also reached the arcades in 81 as an attempt by Nintendo to create a rival to Pac-Man, which was released in 1980. Most people are probably aware that the 80s also included the great video game crash of 1983, not helped by Atari having no idea how to set reasonable deadlines. Nobody learns, do they? But the resurgence that followed can be put down to the success of the ROB toy bringing Nintendo to the American market. Rob may not have lasted like... Was Rob ever successful, Rob the Robot? I don't think...
No, but he's cute.
I had a Rob.
I had a Rob as well.
Couldn't figure out how it worked.
Mistakes, definitely.
To this day, it's still on my mind.
Never got past the first...
You can have mine.
We never got past the first level. Me and my brother couldn't figure out how to do it.
He's cute, but he's really like... The plastic's mucky on him now.
Oh, man, you know what honestly. I mean? What the fuck was that all about?
Rob may not have lasted that long, but I think that it's arguably one of the biggest impacts a marketing tool has ever had on the industry. Fair enough. Yeah. Put simply, without everything that happened in the 80s, the games industry would look totally different today. The Mario franchise is numerically the best-selling video game franchise in history. And what's in second place? Oh, would you look at that? It's Tetris. And that started in 1988, probably the best thing to come out of the Soviet Union. The whole era was, if you'll pardon the pun, a complete game changer and set the bar astonishingly high despite a relatively low technological level compared to the systems that followed up on it on the 90s. I'm telling you, it's cocaine. Fun. The only reason those games had such a wide selection of games at the time, cocaine and cigarettes.
Because nobody slept. They just sniffed up and smoked.
What if this little Italian plumber, right, goes to this, what we call the Mushroom Kingdom, and he eats a mushroom and he gets bigger? Then he eats a flower and he fires fireballs.
Yeah. Yeah. Cocaine.
Cocaine. And the bad guy is a big dinosaur.
Yeah. It's all cocaine, mate.
I mean, the thing is, without video games, we'd all just be sat in dark rooms listening to repetitive music, eating pills.
We wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
Chasing ghosts.
No, I don't think I'd. No, we definitely wouldn't be doing this podcast.
This podcast wouldn't exist without video games.
True.
Not a chance, not a prayer. So, yeah, is that everything from our listeners?
Yes, that's everything from the listeners.
Excellent. So, as always, links to all our extracurricular activities are in our show notes and at modernescapism.co.uk. And please consider becoming a patron to help support our endeavour from as little as £1. Wow.
£1.
Next week.
Make sure you go and listen to Smash That Glass. The first episode came out. Candy's new podcast.
Yes, absolutely. I'm not going to discuss my thoughts on it yet, but I've listened to it. That's all you'll need to know.
You make it sound so bad.
Yeah.
Oh, no. No.
It was great.
No.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
No.
They've done a great job.
I want people... I'm very, very, very looking forward to where that's going to end up. Oh, love it. Yeah, that's my farce. Love it. next week... Spoiler alert. It's great. Next week, we will be giving each other an album from the 80s to review. Of course we are. We love these little album things that we started this year. Are we going to divulge them now or in the Patreon?
No, we do it in the green room.
We'll do it in the green room. We're locking it behind a paywall. Womp womp. So, if you're not one of our patrons, you're going to miss out on that. You're going to miss out on that and Nexus Plus and other stuff, honourable mentions and stuff. So, that's been a show for you guys, but we'll see you in the green room, patrons. So, good night.
Bye.
Laters.
I've tried taking supplements for it, and I just can't find it.
Yeah, do you know what? I think there's only one man that can introduce it. Dean, take it away.
I do need to point out that it's not Dean that does that. It's Monk's Boy.
Is it?
Yeah.
Start again.
If I were Dean.
No, you said it like three times. I've cut it out every time because it's Monk's boy that gave us that.
Let me start again.